Morsenal Studio B in Chandler, Arizona, this is MayaCast. Welcome to another edition of MayaCast. I'm your host, Tom Shadle.
I'm your host, Kip Parcell.
And this is episode 250 for Friday, October 25th, 2019. Fallout 4. Coming up on today's show, we are our quarter of a millennia show. We are going to be discussing Arizona Armageddon that happened last week, well, a couple weekends ago when this comes out, because we missed a week there. But yeah, we're going to do the recap of Armageddon. We'll talk about the event and everything that went down. Kip will talk about his games because he actually came to this Armageddon and got to play. And so that's what we're talking about on this 250th episode of MayaCast. Thank you for sticking around this long. And if you're new, hey, welcome. Go leave us a 5-star review on iTunes. Does iTunes exist anymore? Isn't there a new update where there's no more iTunes, it's just Apple Music?
Something like that. Like, yeah, Apple Pod something.
Anyway. So, before we get to all the fun reminiscing about the amazing weekend we had, Kip, you have an event for us.
I do, and it is a narrative event happening in Lawrence, Kansas, and it's coming in from Andrew. Says, dear Tom and Kip, here are the details for their narrative event. It is going to be a 200-point event with a 12-point spec ops. One list. Oh, this is a one list Willet. Yeah, did you hear that creep out? Was that pretty?
I could hear it across the room.
Oh, my goodness. I don't know what that was. That was a take a drink of beer. I was trying to escape. But yeah, this is a one list Willet format. your other host this evening is Kip's stomach. So the entry fee for this will be $10, and the max amount of players is 20. So here's what you're going to be dealing with. A Pan-Oceanian corporation on Svalheimr recently made a breakthrough in reverse engineering combined army voodoo tech. It's huge. Give them all plasma. In response, Yu Qing has organized a multinational task force to secure this tech for themselves. But hidden Shizvasi agents have flagged the research sites for sabotage to prevent human spheres from securing an advantage over the EI. So, will you join the valiant Pano-led corporate defense force? Or will you spot or the Yujing sponsored Winter Wolves tax force? Or do you want to be part of the Combined Army Saboteurs? I would probably be part of the Combined Army Saboteurs, yes.
I choose C.
I choose C. C. So this it'll be a 3-round event. During the first 2 rounds, human teams will compete to earn upgrades for the final round. The aliens will try to complete their hidden agenda to unlock sabotage cards for the final encounter. The final round will be a 2-on-2 game to determine the fate of the Svalheimr Research Center. Most tables will have some sort of terrain effect rules, and the majority of the missions are going to be very similar to ITS missions, so you need to make sure you bring your specialists. The spec ops who achieves the highest kill count will win a copy of Outrage with Knauf. Hope to see you all there. It's sponsored by Two Pitchers Brewing. That's awesome. So they will be giving away some of their products as door prizes to those who are over the ages of 21, as well as samples of some of their delicious brews during the tournament. So this comes from Drewski, actually. That sounds amazing.
That inspired me to doodle a beer glass while you were reading it.
You know what? I would like to do more narrative events like that. That's really cool.
Well, I know that our friend John Leiby is very creative and likes to do narrative things. So you should get together with him and...
I'll just give him the idea and be like, John, we should really do a narrative event. And I'll just have to make sure I'm available for it.
Story time at the boathouse.
Oh, that would be amazing. We need to do another boathouse event.
All right. So if you would like your event announced on the show, send all of the pertinent details, including the date and the place, and a link to Tom at MayaCast.com.
And Kip's stomach at MayaCast.com.
And we will put up a link in the show notes and keep them there until the event's over so that people can... And we put the location next to it, like the city and state or the city and country or whatever, in parentheses next to it. So you can hit the full show notes at MayaCast.com and look through those events and see if there's one either near you or near a place you're traveling to. Or maybe there is a place you always wanted to travel to, and this will give you the extra excuse to play some Fun Infinity. Speaking of Fun Infinity, let's talk about the Arizona Armageddon 4 weekend.
Yeah, we just got our asses kicked.
Requesting evac. Repeat, requesting evac.
Control systems report considerable damage and casualties.
Mission debrief.
Okay, so the weekend of October 12th and 13th, 72 people came to Mesa, Arizona, and competed in Arizona Armageddon 4. And so we had seven. I'm going to go over just sort of the details of the event and whatnot, and then Kip's going to talk to you about his games and his Dahshat list and how he fared and stuff. But The most astonishing thing to me is we had 72 players. All 72 arrived and showed up, right?
On time, even.
And then all 72 came back for day two. We didn't have any drops, right? Mm-hmm. Like all 72 people, we started with 72, we finished with 72. That's amazing. Like I've never, we do a 16 round tournament and we'll have a drop because somebody's got to go pick up a kid for an emergency or whatever, right? We had one player who missed one round, but Utah brought a ringer, and so Brody got to play one game as a substitute, so he didn't have to put somebody on the bye rest. So, but then they were able to come back for the final round, right? So we started with 72, ended with 72. We had one round, one game substitute, but other than that, like perfect attendance, no drop. So that just blows my mind. That made me really happy because there's always drops. And the OTM, when there's a drop, the OTM goes, I don't know. So, what a load of stress off. We had players from two different countries and 16 different U.S. states.
Nice.
The two countries being the United States and Sweden.
Rasmus.
And Rasmus McDowell. The most, of course, were from Arizona. It's our home event, so we're going to have the most. We had 22 out of the 72 were from Arizona. And then Utah, New Mexico tied it up at 8 people for second place, followed closely behind by Colorado's 7 and California's 6. So step it up, Nevada. You only brought 5. Your 4-hour drive. Come on, Vegas. And then nobody from like Reno or... anywhere else. Anyway, people from 16 different states, from as far away as Florida and Washington. So we have the corners represented. And I want to give a big shout out to the people that helped me do the judging and organization. John Leiby especially put in a lot of work behind the scenes because I actually delegated work, which I'm not good at, like got to do everything myself, right? But John helped me out a lot doing stuff on the computer for me and whatnot. Sterling, you know, contacted our social event vendors and stuff, and he was there judging. And then we had Jeff Rossiter from up in Utah who came down and completed his Four Corners Infinity Circuit judging resume. He's now judged at all four of the Four Corners events for Utah, Colorado, New Mexico, and Arizona.
That's pretty amazing.
So those three guys did an amazing job. There was very little to no drama at all weekend long. And the judges did a great job with the rulings. I got zero after the event complaints from anybody about a ruling that was wrong or anything. And with 72 players and 4 judges, there's bound to be something that got mixed up and usually hear about it. And this year so far, a week and a half later, nothing. So, that's really good. And so thank you very much to those guys. You do need help for a big event like this. So I'm glad they, were able to help. And you definitely need more than one judge for 72 people. So, I'll get into the game stuff in a bit, but one thing that I'm really proud about our attendees for doing is that, so back in Salt Lake, Kip and I won an Onyx Army, and then different people from our local Arizona Infinity group each painted a different one of those Onyx models from the 300-point box, and we raffled it off for charity. Our charity was the V Foundation for Cancer Research. And if you have not seen Jim Valvano's speech from the SBs where he says, don't give up, don't ever give up, you should take 10 minutes and YouTube that because it's very inspirational. Anyway, so $5 raffle ticket, and the winner gets to take home a fully painted 300-point Onyx Army painted by different members of the Arizona Infinity community. And we had a lady from Colorado named Nina who came, and Nina Del Cavo came, and she was raffle mama. She was like, hey, do you want help with the raffle? I can sell raffle tickets. I was like, oh my God, what a load off. Yes, please. And she also had to play all of her games, right?
Oh, that's
but
right.
In between every round, she was bullying people into buying raffle tickets.
I was one of those. She actually posted on Facebook, like, hey, all my gaming friends, how did you meet me? And I wanted to put like that kid that's like, where's my $2 from that old movie with John Cusack? You don't remember that? Oh, man. I just wanted to do that. I'm glad I didn't, because I would have been the only one that got that joke. It was awesome, though. She did a great job.
But Raffle Mama did an awesome job, and we challenged the group because we had 800 and something, 850, I think, on the first day. And maybe it was over 900, because the second day I was like, I bet you we can get to $1,500. And I told that to the group before we started on Sunday. And she pushed hard, and everybody gave hard. And then there were three real generous donors, one at the end specifically to bring us right up to the $1,500 mark. Because we were a little bit short. So I announced the total. Right, it was like $1,380, right? And then 5 minutes later, they're like, wait, new total. And we had one more donor put in that extra $120 to get it up to $1,500. So we raised $1,500 for the V Foundation for Cancer Research.
Did they want to be anonymous? Who did that?
I don't know, so I'm...
I would remain.
But judging by what I think his personality is like, I think he would like to be anonymous. So yeah,
that's cool.
But yeah, so then we raffled off the Onyx, and George Bailey Kirby from Vegas was the lucky winner.
Yeah, he was.
So he got to take home that army. But the important thing is that it raised $1,500 for cancer research in the 2 days of the tournament. So you guys that were there, you guys are awesome. Thank you so much for your generosity, because F cancer. And then while I'm doing shout outs, I want to thank the four people that brought me big bottles of whiskey. Just out of the blue, out of nowhere, Mike Bohr brought me his favorite one from Texas. It was a Herman Marshall Texas bourbon. Nina, again, from Colorado, brought a Peach Street bourbon. It is not a peach-flavored bourbon. Peach Street is just the name of the distillery. And it's a really good, really good bourbon out of Colorado. Little pepper kick to it that I like a lot. Lance Kidwell from Vegas, he brought a bottle of Knob Creek rye, because he's like, I was listening to you talk about Sazeracs, and you know, he's like, so, you know, I don't just listen to the podcast, I understand. So he brought me rye whiskey to make Sazeracs with. And then Utah brought a it was High West Campfire whiskey from Utah. Because, you know, they hear me talk about how I like smoky whiskeys, like the Lafroig Scotch and whatnot. And so they wanted to find a smoky whiskey from Colorado, and they definitely succeeded. And it's delicious with barbecue. So it's like a smoked whiskey. Good stuff. And so, yeah, just whiskey from the sky all weekend long, which was fantastic. So thank you for, well, three people and a state. Thank you guys for doing that. Definitely not necessary. You guys are amazing people. Thanks for that. On to the result. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So, the most, well, and stats and stuff. I'll skip down to the results. The best, the number one player was the guy from Sweden, Rasmus McDowell.
So deserved it. Flew the farthest. Such a cool guy. And he was playing Merovingia.
And he played Merovingia. So
that was a win for everyone.
Merovingian Rapid Response Force, you know, that garbage faction that nobody plays because it's not competitive.
Yeah.
That is the winner of Arizona Armageddon IV.
And he played top table against
Myomer,
who was playing Assassins. So that, I mean, it was, I was loving it. Yeah. I loved how it ended, too. Like, why he won.
And now, usually, what happens is the person who's on top table and loses gets knocked down to, like, fourth or fifth or something like that, mm-hmm. right? Because it's a loss. But in the weird vagaries of math and the excellent all-weekend-long performance of Lewis, and by virtue of getting as many objective points as he could,
mm-hmm.
Despite losing that final match to Rasmus on... Well, okay, that's a whole different story. Myomer came in second.
Yeah.
With Hassan Baram. In third place. And now, so Rasmus had 13 tournament points
mm-hmm.
and 42 objective points. Lewis had 12 tournament points and 38 objective mm-hmm. points, right? And then in third place, 12 tournament points and 37
objective
points. By one objective point, James Keller, Wake the Ghost,
nice.
From Texas, came in third with his Varuna.
Yeah, he's pretty good. I was right behind the Rasmus and Lewis when they were playing, and I heard Rasmus scream, and I was like, that means you won, right? And then he said, yes, and gave me a big old hug. On it's, a freaking liaison roll at the end of the game.
So the thing was, they were... Rasmus was up by one objective point.
Yeah.
So he was going to win the game. And then they remembered the liaison officer role, right? And Lewis passed his.
Oh.
So now they're tied.
Oh, no.
Right?
Yeah.
And then, so Rasmus... rolls his and he doesn't want to look at it. He can't look at it, right? Because
yeah.
it's the whole, it's for all the marbles, right?
Yeah.
So he can't look at it. And Lewis sees the number, right? And tells him, okay, when you look, don't freak out. We're going to look up liaison officer. And he looks down and it's a 15. But you read liaison officer in acquisition
mm-hmm.
and liaison officer, it's a whip plus 3 roll.
Yeah.
No. So he just passes it, and which then puts him up 1 point. So yes, he won it on a liaison officer role, but luckily the liaison officer didn't change the outcome because they both
passed. Okay, I did not know that.
Yeah, they both succeeded at the role. So
that makes it even crazier because
right?
then Lewis passes. He's like, no,
right? And yeah, Lewis like kept him calm. He said, "Don't freak out. Yeah. I'm going to look up." Lee is an officer to see if it's whip or whip plus 3.
Yeah.
Scrolls through, finds it on comlog, shows it to Rasmus and says whip plus 3, and that's when he screamed.
Oh, that's funny. Oh, my gosh.
In fourth place, from California, we had Polynikes. I'm going to go Polynikes. And he also had the 12 tournament points, and he had 35 objective points. Then in fifth place, from Arizona, Chainsaw, Tim Adair, 12 and 33. So it's really tight stacked up at the top. You go to sixth place, you've got Zach, viciously effective Zach from Arizona. and so he
was
also
he, 12
has,
at-
he also has 12.
Okay.
He also has 33. But Tim had 773 victory points, and Zach had 701.
Oh, wow.
So by 72 points of dead models,
yeah.
That flip, that's 5
over
and 6.
Over the course of 5 games. Mm-hmm. That's so close.
In 7th, from Florida, so we're all over the country in the top 10, man.
Mm-hmm.
Florida is in 7th place. Jay Walker, the guy who designs everything and owns Warsenal, he was there. He was vending some Warsenal stuff.
Yeah, he didn't get to relax at all. He was playing and jumping over to the table.
No, I stopped doing factions. I'm sorry. James Keller, Texas Varuna. Remember that? So then in fourth place, Polynikes. For those of you that know him, no, he only plays Vanilla Combined Army. Combined. Chainsaw, this time, is playing Vanilla Yu Ching. And then in sixth place, Zach was playing Toha.
Mm-hmm.
Seventh place, Mulciber, Jay Walker from Florida. He was also playing Toha. And then in eighth place, we shoot over to Indiana, where James Chaveau, came in eighth with his Steel Phalanx. Then Washington State for ninth place, Tony Fern with his USARF.
Beautiful, beautifully painted USARF.
And then in 10th place, rounding out the top 10th, the top 10, right? we have Savinky Dink, who is Mike Beyer, the creator of Comlog. He's from Missouri, and he played with Spiral Core.
Nice. I didn't know that was his ITS name. That's kind of funny.
Savinky Dink. Yeah, so you've got the owner of Warsenal in there in the top 10. You've got the guy who created Comlog in the top 10. Mimer, of course. Polynikes, of course. But Sweden winning the entire thing with Merovingia is...
so sweet. It's so sweet.
Chef fingers kissed, yes. Like gif. Mwah. So those are the top 10. We had best table awards, and Zach, local guy Zach, viciously effective Zach, won for his full Cosmica table. Well, 99% Cosmica, 1% Jedi Starfighters.
There you go. Yeah, because of all the landing. All
little
the
landing pads. But he did up, I don't even know how many different facades and frames of Cosmica. He's got like the whole Tunguskan jurisdictional command thing in the center. And so many more. Like it's the, I think it's the first fully painted, full Cosmica table like that that I've seen. I've seen Guillermo's where a lot of it's like styrofoam mountains and stuff. And
with some of it in there.
And it's converted and whatnot. And that, it's cool. So that's the first fully painted one I've seen. But like just it's like out of the box. Lot of work, and it looked great.
He deserved it. He worked really hard for that.
Pete Meyer from New Mexico came in second. We had a second best table award because I ordered one from Warsenal. And young Nathaniel Faint, who made all the best painted awards, he also made a best table award that I don't... he says, you wanted it. I don't remember asking him for that. Or not asking for it, but like... But whatever, it was cool because it let us give a another best table award, and these were done by the attendees. They had a little slip in their bag that they could fill out which table number was their favorite looking table, and Pete Myers was all scratch built, this wilderness, this like desert wilderness with like a stream running through it and barren trees,
like caves.
I guess not really desert because there's a lot of lichen and stuff.
Yeah.
And that was some of the cool stuff, like when there were vines hanging down the sides of mountains, you could use those as ladders.
Yeah, his terrain rules were really cool.
Yeah. And it was just...
saturation zones.
Really all really natural looking without having all your models fall all over the place. And very cool. And everybody wanted to play on that one. So
that table made Kenzie go... because Kenzie came in like during lunch on day one and was going through and looking at all the armies and the tables and stuff. And she saw it. She goes... now, this is cool. Like, if you want to do something like this, I totally would want to build something like that with you. And then I saw that Joy and Dan did their, like, Tatooine like that. And I was like, Infinity, table building, bringing couples together since forever. But, yeah, she was super, super stoked with a lot of the tables and stuff. And Kalani just wanted to grab all the people's minis, which was no good.
We gave out best painting awards for each major faction. Not for each sectorial, but each parent faction, right? And the best Aleph was DM Walking 88. That's Jackson Probst from Utah. Best Ariadna, Zhukov 2. That's Tony Fern again from Washington.
These were good.
Combined Army was Silver Pants Blue. That's Curtis Katzman out of Nevada.
One of the best names ever for ITS, by the way.
And so we were at Las Vegas Open like two or three years ago. And they kept calling Silver Pants Blue, and you kept saying, that's so awesome. And I said, I don't get it. So Kip explained to me, 40-year-old virgin.
Yes.
And as soon as he said that, I remembered I remembered Steve Carell painting miniatures. I'm going to paint your silver pants.
Yeah, baby. I died when they yelled that out.
So
loud.
Now, yeah. So thank you for
stupid movie
fixing
quotes.
My brain. Hakaslam, New Mexico. Pete Trujillo, Truxio with the best painted Hakaslam. Best NA2 was some guy from Arizona named Kip Luis Parcell.
What? I was really stoked.
With his Mando Dahshat. Mm-hmm. Best Nomads was Bruno DeCourt from Missouri, Brunix. Very cool. To me, it struck me like it was supposed to be like at night. Everything looked like it was nighttime.
Yeah.
That's how I interpreted it. Best O12 was D's Nuts. Dan Nuss from Colorado.
Good old Dan.
He was also the only O12. But that takes nothing away from the excellent job he got on the start of his army. Can't wait to see the rest of it all finished up. Panu Shianya goes to our own Nathaniel Faint from Arizona.
He did a good job on
that. So
those.
He made a plaque, and then he got a plaque.
Yeah, I know, right?
Toha, I mean, winning all the awards is Zach Mayhew, Rick
right?
X. He had best painted Toha. He's from here in Arizona. And then Nimrod, Brody Shade from Utah, not Shadle, not to be, no relation. He got best Yujing.
Nice.
Now, the all important state rankings. To get best state, we take the top three players. And just like a tournament, we compare total tournament points, objective points, victory points, right? You have to have three players to play along. So, and you only take the top three of each state, right?
Yes.
So, yes, Arizona had 22 people, but we're only taking the top three performers.
It evens it out.
In eighth place, Nevada. That's still, if you can hear that, that's still Kip's stomach.
Good night.
Eighth place, Nevada. Seventh place, the Florida-Georgia Coalition. So we had Bill Evans, who won last year's Armageddon, mm-hmm. and we had Jay from Morrisonal. So those guys are from Florida. And then Markman Lapis. I mean, Georgia's like the next state up from Florida. So Markman Lapis was here from Atlanta, so we put them together. So that seventh place. So not even a whole state, still beat Nevada. But it's okay, Nevada. You have your own event in December that we're going to come and visit you guys for. And well, Kip's not because he's about to have a baby.
I wanted to go to that.
But
so
a lot
bad.
Of us from Arizona are coming to visit, and I'm sure you're going to win best state at your own event. Sixth place was Missouri.
Wow.
Four dudes from Missouri. Moxel and Joxel and Greg Patterson and Bruno. In fifth place was Colorado, which is weird because in fourth place was New Mexico.
What's up with that first
so
and fun
first,
last,
right?
last in points? Come on, guys.
First and fun, last in points.
You got to quit getting good.
edges out Colorado. And then in third place, even odder, is Utah.
What?
So Utah came to play. In second place was California. Mm-hmm. And then that only leaves one for first place, and it's State 48, buddy.
You know it.
So, and
State
then
48.
And then we were able to earn, despite not having a lot of points at the Krug, because only one person from Arizona was able to go to the Krug.
We had three.
Well, and two played as one.
Yeah.
Because they also brought their kid and had to hand off between games. Who's one person would. So
we technically met the minimum for that.
Shane and Sierra were both there, but they were only entered as one player because they had to switch off with the kids. Anyway, so we took a hit at the Krug and moved out of first place for total points for the FCIC. But we got enough points at Arizona Armageddon to get first place for the year.
Yes.
The 2019 Four Corners Infinity Championship champions, Arizona, baby.
Love it. I love when you announce that, too, because Jeff from Shiv Games, we had a bet on the Cardinals-Falcons game, and the Falcons had just scored a touchdown, so if they kick the extra point, they tie it, and their kicker missed it. And then I was like, oh my gosh, we're up by one and all we need is a first down. And as Tom's announcing these, we got the first down to win. And he goes, Arizona. And I was like, yes, as loud as I could. And I was like, man, I really didn't scream for Arizona. It was just because that I'd won the bet against Jeff at that exact moment. So
most people during the award ceremony are applauding their fellow Infinity players for their achievements. Kip is ignoring everything and watching the Cardinals game on his tiny little phone.
Yeah, Jeff, it was 2 minutes. Won the bet, though. Way to go, Cards. And I did feel like a big jerk face, though. I apologize to Tom probably 3 times on Monday.
So, yes, thanks to everybody who helped out, and not just the judges I named or Raffle Mama, but also all of the people who were there just to play and have a good time. You had to pay to be there and just came up and said, what can I help with? What can I do? Whether it was rolling tractor tires out of the gully so we could unwarp a board and getting your shin all scraped to hell on a cut down bush out back of the store. Please don't sue Games U. Just setting up tables or just people offering left and right if they could help. And I oftentimes didn't have a thing I could think of for them to help, but know that I appreciate all the offers of help and all the help that I received. Community is great. Thank you so much for an amazing, amazing weekend. I had a blast. I hope you all had a blast, and I hope you all come back next year, because what a good time. So, Kip.
Yeah.
Let's talk about your Arizona Armageddon experience.
So it was AZA 4, and if you are a long listener of the show, you know that I only show up to the even numbers of Arizona Armageddon. I have gotten better with my communication skills, so I was able to attend this year instead of telling Tom one thing and then, there's a bunch of people that sign up for a date and then I'm like, oh crap, that's the wrong weekend. Well, yes, I suck again. But yeah, it was super fun. I love doing these big events in the backyard, because we go to Rumble, we go to Salt Lake, would love to make it to the Krug again with the switching. I think that we can make that happen. But it's fun to see it from the other side to where it's in your backyard, just right down the road, and you have all these people visiting your hometown and you get to host them. So it's super, 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 super cool. Had 5 amazing games. I didn't play amazing in all of them, but I the spread and the people that I got to play ended up being really freaking cool. I got challenged round 1 by Esteban, the German, so I had to say it in Spanish, from Utah.
Makes sense to Kip.
I know, right? And that's Lokiel, and he brought Varuna.
Low kill.
Low kill, sorry.
No, I'm high saying kill. It that way.
Oh.
Low kill.
I always just thought like Loki because he's German, and then I was thinking Viking. He's like a Viking warrior, so I think Loki.
He was proficient with the axes in New Mexico, that's
yes,
for sure.
Yes, he's got the genes.
Stephen Schmidt, yeah.
Yes. Super cool guy, love him to death. Brought Varuna against my Dahshat, and I was like, oh man, I haven't practiced Varuna in a long time. Thank you, John Leiby, for beating me up with them a lot because I anticipated some things that would happen, but not all. Really close game too. I ended up getting a minor win because at the end of the game. And we were playing frontline, so you're trying to move into zones and guest zones. I had moved my liaison was my Hunzikut, Fort mm-hmm. Observer, had.
Yeah. If you want to hear about Kip's lists and his plans mm-hmm. for the weekend, listen to episode 249, where he discusses his Dahshat lists and how he was going to use them for these 5 missions.
Yeah. Not going over those today, but yeah, moved my Hunzikut up and I had him sitting there cause it's my Mando. So it's actually a male Hunzikut. Ran the facade up the same side because I needed to. There's my gut again. Because I needed to. I had one of those like veteran troop HVT things I needed to do. So I was like, ah, Alpha Seed to the rescue for my classified. So I move up, and I didn't think that I was in his closest to his deployment zone to get that the max points, right? And he had put one of his helots with a light rocket launcher there, and I was like, he only has one shot. I'll move out and I'll smoke that thing, right, to make sure that I can get a little closer. Well, I didn't think about the fact that you need to worry about the template. So when he shot at me and I shot with my four back, we put the template down and it was so close. I'm like, is it in? Is it out?
Did you get your Hunzikud hit?
Yeah, and it was one of those ones we could have called the judge over, but it's no. At this point, it's my mistake. And if it's close enough, we're going to let you hit it.
And don't helots have neurocinetics, so it was two shots?
It was two shots. Yeah. It's funny that you said that, because I thought he was in suppression fire because he rolled more than one dice, but you can't go into suppression fire with a light rocket launcher. Nope. It was neurocinetics, yep. So yes. So he shot back with two. So close that at that point, it's hey, we're just going to play it as it's a hit. It's not close enough to get a judge. It's the last order of the game. It's been a good game. I made the mistake. Can't take that from him, right? He succeeds, but I succeed better, and I kill that helot. But that success, it's my Hunzikud, smokes the liaison officer. This is important, because when we tallied up points, my Facede was in the far one, so I get points for that. I had my closest zone, so I get points for that. But he beat me in the middle. And what that caused us to do is, if my Hunzikud would have survived, we would have tied the middle, and I would have won 6-0. But instead, he smoked the Hunzikud and got 3 points, or I would have won 6-1, because he got the middle, and then I didn't get anything. So I got a minor victory out of that, and I was laughing. I was like, dang, I should have thought about that for popping him out there and shooting at a neurocinetics freaking helot. But that's what makes these games fun, especially when we add up points. I'm like, we were exactly the same amount of points in that, and that was with his guy, dude.
I still think about dumb stuff from years ago. I think it was 3 rumbles ago when I played Bryant
Shinrung.
Yep, and he was playing as JSA back when I think they were still sectorial, not secessionist.
Yes,
and I was playing TAC before they even had a sectorial. I was just playing.
Yeah, right. Your awesome Ariadna army that you painted,
and. There was a Keisotsu missile launcher I had to get rid of, and I did a very similar stupid thing where I was like, Spetsnaz HMG, or no, it might have been Veteran Kazakh AP-HMG, whatever it was, right? Move that around to the corner where I can get line of fire to it, not thinking about the camo marker that's right there that was planning to go around that corner later.
Mm-hmm.
So when he hit, if the missile succeeds, even though, I smoked the Keisotsu, that template goes down for the missile and catches that camo token, which was the Spetsnaz, and wipes out that camo marker. So yeah, I've done similar stupid things, man.
Yeah, it was cool too, because he had a Hari's team that just survived my rush from the Ruishi, and I was like, if I would have took one down, I would have took the middle. His Echo Bravos, he had 2 of them. In his first one, I was expecting one, but then forgot about it and moved everybody. And then when he dropped it, I was like, oh man, you have a clear line. I was like, I can't see you here, because, we do the laser pointer. Line of fire goes both ways. Game goes way faster if you help each other out. So I put my line of fire out, and I'm like, yep, you have a full line to run back and just freaking template my fire team. So he starts doing that, get some smoke down. Well, I threw smoke with McMurrow to kind of force him out a little bit to get line of fire, so that if he did shoot everybody with my sixth sense level 2, I could shoot back. And thank goodness for sixth sense level 2, because I didn't lose anybody. And his Echo Bravo went down, but he had McMurrow and like four of my fire team in templates, which was scary. Because I believe it was a light rocket launcher. I believe that's a profile on Echo Bravo. I don't have army up right now, but it was scary. There was a couple of, I got lucky on those. The Echo Bravos didn't do a thing to me, which was nice.
It's always easy to remember to cover your corners and sides for drop troops when you're deploying.
Mm-hmm.
But then when you go first,
yes,
and you go on your offensive and do your objectives and things, it's sometimes difficult to remember at the end of turn one, like, oh, wait, I still need to be prepared for those drop troops. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, it was the boarding shotgun, light rocket launcher. Yeah, I survived two shots, one from each.
So instead of winning 6-0, you won by a score of what?
6-3. So it was minor, but it was good. Like, I'm telling you, like, it was a great game down to the very last order. Moved on to round two. Got to play John from New Mexico. Spartois 81. Is that how you say it?
Spartoy.
Spartoy.
I mean, yes, that's how I say it.
This was cool too, because he was playing. So I'm playing Dahshat, but Mando Dahshat. So I was rocking my Mandos. And he was playing Foreign Company. So I was like, oh, we're totally NA2 in it. And he's like, yes. But then while he was deploying the whole time, I was going, bum, 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 bum. I probably shouldn't have did that, because he got really lucky. Like, a lot of rolls against me. Not lucky, like, he played really good, but I was like, man, I gave you a little bit of my mojo back, because we ended up tying. We were playing my least favorite mission of all, and it is, I can't even remember the name of it, because I can't stand it that much. The discovering of the HVTs.
Unmasking?
Yes, thank you. I didn't want to say
that mission.
It's the mission that shall not be named. Tom, you love that mission because you've probably guessed right once or twice. I never guess right. It's always the last one. And when at the end of the game, I was
like... You
gotta
kill the target decoys too, though. It's fine. You need to identify all of them.
The one I wanted to guess first was the one, and then I didn't do it, and I totally... I suck at that mission personally. I don't think it's a bad mission. I'm not saying it's a bad mission. For me personally, it's my least favorite because I suck at it. It was a really good stalemate. Luckily, he put his HMG TR bot in a position to where he thought he could see things, but then once we got into the game, he's like, oh crap, I really can't see anything from here. It's in a high spot, but there's billboards that blocked a lot of things, so it helped me out to get to certain places where I needed to be. But his, I'll tell you what, man, he had two motivated war cores. I started running McMurrow, Mandalore, with his dark saber up to start throwing smoke, and he's like, all I have is flash pulse, so I can't do anything. I'm like, you can still, like, flash pulse me.
Get the face-to-face.
To get the face-to-face, yeah. Which he won 3 times in a row. I was like, come on.
At least they bounce off your fur.
Yeah, so I get stopped the smoke from going down. Super cool, though. Like, I told him, he's like, oh, I didn't know that. I'm like, yeah, that's the way it goes. Really good stalemate. Like, I tried to ascend. This is the list I played, like, my alternate list. And I tried the Hulang. And I was like, ooh, mono close combat. He's got all his characters over there. I have EM grenades. So I cleared a path for the Huilang, roll up there, get smoked by a zero. Then start throwing grenades on his team. Knocked a couple people out, but he got them all back up and my Huilang died, so it was really bad. A-team crew came through. Learned something this game, though. So he got within, because we ended up fighting like in the middle of the table, which you kind of do in a mission like this. He ended up throwing lobbing grenades. And at first, he went to throw smoke, EM smoke with Senior Massacre.
EM smoke is not a thing.
I mean, Eclipse Smoke with Senior Massacre and wanted to apply the +3 for a 5-man fire team. And I was like, I think that's only for ballistic skill value. And then a judge said, yes, it didn't matter because he would have passed anyway. He rolled well underneath. But we had a conversation. And after that, somebody brought it up on their phone. You get +3 to physique.
Mm-hmm.
That was in the new FAQ. Luckily, it didn't affect our game. But I was like, oh my gosh, I only ever use that in Steel Phalanx. So I've never actually looked that you could do that. But it's also with whip value. I was like, that makes Gulab Ford Observers and a 5-man fire team really good at ARO if you're sitting there to whip 17 base for flash pulse. So that I learned that that time. But I already knew that in the last FAQ, just forgot it because I am an idiot. Again, luckily it didn't affect our game because he rolled well underneath it and somebody brought it up after. So we applied that later. But I was actually ahead on activating the consoles and killing more targets. So I'm sitting at 3 and I threw everything at this suppressive fire 0. I threw out my awesome little droid Liberto. I ran Miranda Ashercroft, which was my data tracker, which cost me a point. But at this point, a 4-0 and 3-0 is still a minor. So I was like, F it, let's go. Tried to, because I didn't want him to get more. I was trying to get him to not tie or win. So John's like, you know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to take the 0 and jump. So I shoot with my 2 arrows, miss. Then he just runs, and he suicide runs to shoot my designated target. And does it. And dies, and we tied 3-3. It was awesome. I was like, that was the best. 4 orders. That's all he had was 4 orders. And he made it to 20 inches around a court. It was insane. I was like, you deserve that, John. You deserve that. That was amazing.
If that 0 is not painted, it deserves a paint job.
Right? I can't remember if it was or not. But super fun guy. John's really cool.
So a minor against Steven, a tie against John.
Yes.
And then how did you end the day?
End of the gay day. Day for Bay, if you watch that good old show, Letterkenny. Is it Josh Nordstrom?
He's a person that exists, yes.
Yes.
He's from Colorado.
Yeah, Jay Nordy.
Yeah.
2121.
Josh Nordstrom, yep.
His wife is one of the awesome ladies at Rumble who brings everybody beer.
Oh.
So we've known her. And it was funny. She's like, he goes, how the hell do you know Kip? She goes, Rumble, he drinks a lot. I was like, man, I need to reevaluate my life. So we played Countermeasures, my new favorite mission.
Yeah.
We go there. I'm like, dude, this is my favorite mission. He goes, oh, man, I've only played it a couple times. It scares me. It's your favorite mission. But he taught me something extremely valuable. ISS is the best at countermeasures. So we set up. We're playing on Sterling's kind of like Star Wars-y table.
The corridor interior table?
The
3D printed outside.
The 3D outside, you walk up to that and you're like, oh, this is going to suck. Because it looks really open, but actually when you start playing on it, it's there's not a lot of things that you can get high up on, so it plays very well. Well, I went second, and we flopped Kazovac and experimental drug or something that you need a doctor right away. And Josh is running not what I thought he was going to run. He had Sun Ze and then a whole bunch of Quang Shi and then a Rui Shi. But he didn't run Quang Shi I'm going to run Quang Shi to be suicides. He's like, oh, sweet, Kazovac, I'm going to move and I'm going to use this awesome skill called Biolocator and go unconscious. And I'm going to move my other Quang Shi and Kazovac. I was like, that's genius. I was like, I forgot about Biolocator as a skill. Like, that is insane. And then with the paramedic, same thing. So yeah, ISS is really good at countermeasures because he did 3 off the bat, kind of like when you and I played, because I kind of turtled up. I had a good run to clear some things out. And then always remember to check your environment, people. Because I set my awesome Rui Shi up. without checking line of fire. I just, you know, the Rushi is a very, it's a very, the model makes you think it's bigger than it is. So I set my Rushi up.
It's very short.
Yeah. And well, luckily he gave me, like, we didn't even really measure it at first. He gave me the shot on his, took his out, but then I was trying to cover his other Quangshi to my right on his far, like my right far side of the table. And when he came out, I was like, oh, let me check line of fire. Do you have a silhouette? And I put a silhouette up. I was like, dude, I can't even see over this thing. So he gave me a free shot with it.
Those
for one.
The combat remotes are much taller than the actual.
Yeah, they're like silhouette. Twice the size. I'm like, yeah, dude, I can't even deceiving. See. I was like, so I technically shouldn't have been able to shoot anyway because I had a dead facade there, so I couldn't like stay at the corner.
Like, what is up with that? Cool. What is up with that silhouette? Guys on motorcycles are not that short.
I know, right? It's ridiculous. So that totally smoked me though, because man, having a 5-member fire team of chain rifles roll up on your crew was. I remember he goes, "I'm gonna shoot." I'm like, "I'm gonna have to shoot because you're just gonna do it for 5 more orders, and I'm not gonna pass that many dodges."
I was at your table for that moment.
So killed the one, but yeah, he put me in a. But this is what I like about countermeasures. Even though he was totally tilting me, I still was able to try to come back. Like, you have to. It makes you think outside of the box, and you always kind of have a chance. It's like infinity at its core. But then in the last, my last turn, I had no chance. I had 1 to his 4. But Predator was still on the table. I was like, I'm going to get Predator with this tractor mule. 'Cause I electric pulsed one of his guys. I fought that guy and took it out in close combat. And, he goes, "Oh my gosh, you just, okay, there's your first one." Then I roll around the corner. And then move up, tank a bunch of armor rolls, get into close combat. And he goes, "You literally are going to get Predator with a tractor mule. Minesweeper." And I'm just running people over. Here's why I made a mistake, though. I was like, "Oh, I'll electric pulse to try to, like, shock him, right? So I get a free hit." Should have just attacked, because then he hit me. And then I pass the armor roll. But then I think it was, like, his turn, and he shot into close combat and took it out. Oh, that's what he does, the ARO. He's like, "I'm going to shoot into close combat. I don't care if I hit my guy." And he took his guy out and took out my tractor wheel. I was like, no. But then I forgot that you could actually close combat somebody that's unconscious, because I had a Camille with 3 orders left that could have ran up and just like attacked him in close combat.
Yeah.
That wouldn't have been as cool, though. Like, that's kind of like the cheaty way to get it.
Totally.
Yeah, I forgot about that, though. Ruben Polonikes actually brought that up. When we were talking about the game, he's like, "Why don't you go combat the close combat guy?" I was like, I forgot about that. But still, it was funny to like actually have a chance to do that with a tractor mule, little 5-point minesweeper, running people over. Good game though. He beat me 10-1, so I got smoked that one.
All right, so all that's left for you now for day 2 is a major, because you've got a minor, a tie, and a loss.
Yeah.
So all you need to do is get a major. Right. You got 2 games to do it. Let's see what happens.
They get it out. So that night we went to Beer Research Institute. It's a really cool place.
Be all right.
Yeah, right. It's across the street from the game store. Across the street from our game store is a big like Walmart, bunch of restaurants.
Big shopping center.
Yeah, movie theater. Bunch of cool restaurants. I love the location of our game store. It's perfect. There's anything you could want around there. But BRI is a craft beer, craft food, very unique. So a lot of people like to go there because you're not like, the stuff they have there, you don't just get anywhere else. 480G, that's my favorite beer that they have. So this is important because we're hanging with one of the guys from Tucson. His name is Daniel. And we always talk, and we were telling him, like, you know, we need to like kind of unite the Tucson and Phoenix crews like we used to before.
For those not familiar with our geography, Tucson is about 90 minutes south of Phoenix.
Yeah. So we used to go down there a lot when Kevin was doing stuff. They had a game store shut down. He left. So we're trying to kind of unite the two quote unquote metas. So we're chatting. He's a cool guy. I like him a lot. I'm like, dude, your total friend status. We get paired the first round. I was like, gosh, how did this happen? We saw each other's names pop up and we were laughing. I was like, how ironic, right? And this was, what was round four?
Round four was a firefight.
Yes, it was a firefight. Yes, yep. This is right, because it's, you know, kill the lieutenants and stuff. And he had Starco. And I did not win. I only went first like one time. He had Starco, and I was like, ugh, this sucks. Because
you're expecting just Emily Handelman firing EM grenades at you from.
And regular.
With no line of fire, like all game long.
And it's kill the lieutenant, and I have the most obvious lieutenant in the world.
Yep.
So I deployed my obvious Lieutenant Gulam prone on a roof with my facade very close by so he can mine next to him, because you can't speculative fire onto a camo token.
Haha.
So that helped me out. Well, there was a valid model there.
You can if there's a valid model nearby, yeah.
But the fact that the camo token was there made him never think about doing that. So, Daniel, yes, you can, because I had a valid model there.
Nasty.
But I didn't know that. I was like, oh, I was smart on accident. I was like, oh, no, but I had a valid model there. And it's like, oh. Because, yeah, man, I had, like, the best. So I have a camo token up on this little. We were on a black sheep table, so it was on one of the towers. I have this camo token right at midfield because it's a 16-inch deployment zone. So for deployment level 2, you're basically an infiltrator. He's like, I'm going to move. And he moves Emily, who's his data tracker, which you get points for killing. And it's Emily, right out in the open.
Time to reveal that camo marker.
I'm going to reveal that in DP. We are within +3 range. He goes, oh, man, I need 7s. Oh, wait, I need 10s because of my X visor. And I don't get, like, surprise attack because it's ARO. I don't have mimetism because I didn't have the camo point. Yeah, because I didn't have the extra point to pay for it. This bit me in the anus. Because I need a 14, and I roll, and I got a 14. I was like, oh, perfect. He rolled his 3 dice or 2 dice. I believe it's, yeah, 2 dice, and he got a 10.
So your crits cancel?
I was like, how could I not have one more point? Because I would have just crit Emily on her first move with the DEP, and game would have been a lot better. So yeah, she survives. I end up getting smoked over there, and man, with his use of forward observing and targeting people, dude, when you're targeted and Emily's firing that rocket launcher on targeted models, there was a whole grenade launching, and oh my gosh, it was brutal. Luckily, I didn't take a lot of damage, and I had a doctor really close by, the Dr. Plus, that brought people back up, because that was rough. Like, he was dropping, like, on 13s from, like, 30 inches away, man. It was just, it was too much. But it was fun. Yeah, it was a really good, kind of swaying match. Luckily, when he was trying to do that, he tried to move out of line of fire from my fire team, but forgot about the facade. So Emily's sitting out on the side of a building. I'm like, two orders, I can just move to the side of this building, get her out of line of fire with the facade with HMG, which I did, and she only went unconscious. So yeah, like, drop that. Ended up doing, like, moving my fire team off the building. Best thing though, those bounty hunters, 12 points, acrolyte cannon, submachine guns. I put, because I went second, I put both of them where they could see his Riot Girl team. I was like, is there any templates in there? No. Do you have any engineers? No. Okay. So when that Spitfire came around and I was like, acrolyte cannon, shut down Spitfire first order.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah. I was like, and I only fired one each.
Right.
Because I had I had a baggage bot right by him, because, like, when I hop off this building, I'm reloading.
It was the tractor mule covered in blood.
Exactly. Yes, from round one. Dude, I'm telling you, adhesive is disgusting. And that helped me out. If his Riot Girl team would have survived, he probably would have rolled the crap out of me. But locking down that Spitfire with an acrolyte cannon was. No, I fired both. I was like, I need all of these.
Oh, okay.
So I fired one with one and two with the other just because I was like, I need an extra dice, which helped. But yeah, then he came over and he blitzened my freaking Rushi, which took it out of the fire team, and I didn't have command tokens left to move it back, but I brought it back up and just let it go on its own rampage. But the star of that show, because we were dancing around each other quite a bit, star of that show was the Hunzikoot, because you have to get more weapons out of the panoplies, who rolled a multi-sniper and was like, I got this side locked down. And then, of course, McMurrow, who was like, I'm going to laugh if he gets an HMG. And I rolled, and it was close. I was like, oh, wait, that's ODD. So McMurrow.
Oh, no.
McMurrow with ODD. Save the day, man.
That's grody.
It was easy because, like, I could run, and I'm like, ooh, you're really far range. You only have a pistol. Like, I'll let you try to hit that shot. Because that's what saved the game for me is, like, most of his models were to one side. Avicenna ran over there, and I just McMurrowed through. Chain rifle and close combated. Didn't kill his lieutenant. His lieutenant was one of two models that survived out of the six that I killed. I was like, damn it. But it ended up being an 8-0 win. Daniel's really cool. And I will tell you what, he played Starco really, and he didn't rely on the speculative fire as like his main tactic, but his tactics were built around doing it in the most opportune time. So it was really good. It was a really tough game.
Awesome.
But McMurrow with ODD, man, that's like having Ajax with ODD. You know what I mean? It was good. Like that helped out a lot. So took care of my major. So now I'm sitting with a minor, a tie, a loss, and a major. I'm like, sweet. Took care of all the things.
You got the sweepstakes. That's a bingo.
Yeah, so I'm like, all right, I've had four cool opponents. Been able to hang out with a lot of cool people. I was like, can I just please have a really cool opponent last? Because now I'm like, I'm probably in the middle of the pack somewhere, you know? Not really fighting for anything at this point. Just here to have fun. And I get paired with Twiggy, who's Trevor from Colorado, and I like him a lot, so...
He's a nice boy.
We had a really good game, man. We were playing, it's Acquisition. I call it the War Machine. Everybody run to the center.
Acquisition, yeah.
And he was playing Assassins.
Oh.
And I got to go first this time, which was awesome, because I got to do the smoke trick, and was like... where I can throw smoke in Marksman and get rid of all the damn long-range weapons that he had. Because he had a Gulam with, like, missile launcher, sniper.
Ugh.
And, like, just totally cutting into where my fire team had to go to. So I was like, McMurrow, go! Marksmanship! Shoot a bunch of Spitfires! And it was funny, too, because it came down to the last turn to where we, like, I made my mad rush to get... activate both control antennas and then control them and then have my data tracker, which was, thanks to you, Tom, Miranda Ashcroft, best data tracker ever, the way I run my Dahshat, run her over there. So
I hear ODD is useful.
Yeah, I know, right? So the only thing is like I redid the list after this to give her the combi rifle because suppression fire would have been better than a shotgun. So... it looked like I was murdering really good. And he had, like, again, four orders. I put him in Lost Lieutenant his second turn. So it came down to his last turn. He had four orders left. I'm sitting there with everything. He smokes my Hunzikoot off one. So now I don't control that one. And then he's like, well, I'm going to use this special order to run his... what is the Naharoon engineer with a shotgun? Right where you can see Miranda Ashcroft out of cover.
Uh-oh.
And we shotgun off. My two at... I'm plus three because he's in cover. So my two on 15s or 16s.
Is it not a five-man team at this point?
No. I was down to a three. So I still got the burst bonus, which was good. And then his one, or his two. So it was two on two, right? And I died. So I went from winning by a lot to only winning 4-0. So it was another minor. Oh, man. But I was like, that was really good. It was a really fun game, though, because, like, both, you know, we know each other. He knows the game really well. It was really fast. Like, we played real quick. And some fun points of the game is Alpha Seed runs out and he's like, I'm going to discover Bob from accounting, and passes. He's like, I'm going to discover and shoot Bob from accounting. And then he dodges, engages, and beats me. So then I went, this sucks. Camo token right over by Bob from accounting. Can you move over here, please? And shoot Shock into close combat. Hit my Facede, hit him twice. So I had two hits, one miss. Mm-hmm. Shock ammo kills the
Fidei.
And passes my armor roll. And that's what I was like. That's where the mark from my Facede paint job came from, is my own droid. And then I just went to suppression fire. But it was fun. I mean, he got around all that suppression fire or just didn't care. He's like, I'm going to lose anyway. I'm just going to go suicide through. That was probably my most... That and then him like smoking my Ruishi with his one shot from his Spitfire on the Janissary, I want to say. I can't remember what Janissary's at, but I took on his Janissary. HMG. I think it was a HMG, and he lit me up from that, and I was like, damn, I had 5 dice at 18s and you beat me with 1. Oh well. Yeah, it was super cool fun game, but that was my highlight of the game. I mean, the rest of it was just, you know, us maneuvering around each other, shooting at good stuff. I literally rushed and had everything.
So you minored me off. You minored that one. Where did you end up in the rankings? What number were you?
Crap, I can't remember. Top half. I think 29, maybe. I was not below 35, which made me happy.
Well, you may not have been in the top 10, but one award I neglected to mention, mm-hmm, in the rundown of all the awards and prizes and stuff, was that not only did Nathaniel Faint make those little plaques for all the individual, mm-hmm, painting factions, we also, the judging crew also selected one best painted overall, and we have the lovely Worsenal plaque, mm-hmm, for that, for best painted, like the best in show kind of award, and your Mandalorian Dahshat won best in show for painting.
Yes, I will tell you, so I was 28th. I just realized that I'm on my thing, and the mouse is actually pointing to the number 28.
Huh.
I am an idiot. I worked really hard. I've never been able to play fully painted. I haven't been able to submit something for like a painting competition in like 10 years, it seems like. And I really wanted to do that just A, to play fully painted, and then see if I get a faction award, right? Which I happened. I was like, sweet, I'm really excited. So I grabbed my faction award, and Tom goes, now for best painted overall. And I go, Tony Fern. Literally said that out loud to the three people that were by me as I walked by, and I heard them say my name. That was better than winning Armageddon for me, because I worked so freaking hard to try to get all of that stuff painted. It was actually starting to stress me out. To have that happen was really, really cool. It made me feel happier than I thought it actually would have. I remember sending you a pic and was like, man, I can't believe this happened. Like, I'm really stoked right now.
As discussed on episode 248, stop hobby time and talking about all the sacrifices and trying to fit in and get a model a week done and all that stuff.
Yeah, it's really not feasible, honestly. Like, going through that, knowing that if I wanted to paint like 40 models, it would take me an entire year on that schedule. I couldn't do it. There's no way. No way.
My biggest regret is that organizing a event of this magnitude left me very little time to be able to visit with everyone as much as I would have liked to. I didn't get to spend nearly enough time with anybody. And I feel bad about that, because I want to spend more time with everybody. So to those I didn't get to spend a lot of time with, I'm sorry. You know, if I'll see you in Vegas or at Rumble or at Salt Lake Showdown or the Krug, then did I get them all? Yeah. I got the Four Corners plus Vegas, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. If I see you there, I won't be running it, so you know, I can hang out more. It was fantastic seeing everybody. Thank you all. If you attended, thank you all so much for coming. If you didn't get a chance to attend, make sure you keep your eyes peeled for registration for next year so you can come out, because it was a really great time. The top 10 were really jam-packed close, so it was high competition with some of the best-ranked players in the world. I mean, Myomer and Chainsaw and Polynikes, mm-hmm. and, right? So a lot of top competition there. Wake the Ghost, Savant, you know, Locke, you know, it was a mm-hmm. real murderer's row. And so great competition, but friendly competition. Mm-hmm. All the way through. I especially enjoyed being there for that bro moment between Lewis and Rasmus, where instead of saying, you know, instead of trying to like be like, oh, 15, that's, you know, you don't have a whip 15, you know, Lewis looked up just to double check it's a plus +3, and it was, and, you know, just all the sportsmanship all around, the camaraderie. I had a great time, and it's because you all came and had a good time. So, thank you very much. And
I do want to give one shout out before you close out.
Okay.
Our good old friend, Donnie Darkside. Donnie is somebody I've known for a long time. He doesn't get to play a lot. And he was super stressed about playing in like a big tournament because he comes from a 40K background, same as I did. That's what we used to play. So him viewing tournaments, he thinks it's one thing. And I say this because any of you out there that think that you haven't played enough or it's a big tournament, just go. Because he sent me about 3 texts thanking me for talking him into playing. I'm like, dude, if you haven't played, then don't expect to win. Just show up, meet new people, and have a good time. He showed up, met people, had a great time, and did far better than he thought he would by not playing. I don't think he's even played a game this year. But he's like, it sparked my interest in Infinity again. I want to start a couple new factions. He's like, I forgot how much I miss you guys hanging out on Monday nights. And he's like, I forgot how much I love the game of Infinity when playing in the right crowd. So these big events, if you are a newer player, don't let it intimidate you, especially with in the Four Corners area, because all of the TOs, including Mr. Thomas Shadel, the main rule is don't be a jerk, everybody be cool, and the community is what it's about. So please don't be afraid to attend something like this because you think that your skill set isn't, it's worth it, your presence is worth it, is what I'm trying to say.
Darth Vader said to Luke,
Luke, I know what you're getting for Christmas.
And Luke said, how could you know what I'm getting for Christmas? Darth Vader says,
I felt your presence.
That was a good one.
Conversation can serve no purpose anymore. Goodbye.
Yes, but why are we using such primitive weapons?
So a couple of announcements that are of interest to you listeners. First is Rumble on Route 66. Registration goes live tomorrow. This releases on a Friday, and registration for Rumble starts on Saturday. And so make sure you're up early on Saturday and ready to go at your computer, because Rumble will sell out quickly, even though they're doing 175 people or something like that this year.
It'll be done in a
182,
day.
I don't know, some crazy number. So Rumble on Route 66, the largest Infinity tournament in the world, the first Dire States event.
Mm-hmm. It's the one that started them all.
Unfortunately, it's in Albuquerque, but you get over that quick because you're inside most of the time. Registration is tomorrow, so make sure you're up early and you don't miss it, because you'd be sad if you miss out. And so that happens tomorrow. Also, they tell me Corvus Belli tells me that a prototype of Defiance is on its way to us so that we can play around with it and then talk about it. And so that the Defiance Kickstarter goes live October 29th.
Which is Tuesday.
So maybe we'll have it before then.
Hopefully.
And if we do, we'll get some sort of review. I don't know if we're going to try and do video or if we're just going to podcast about it or what we're going to do. But as soon as we get that Defiance prototype, we will, if it's really on its way. I mean, just because Belen said it's on its way doesn't mean it's on its way. But
like all the updates during...
Yeah, remember, did you see that? You see that video for Interplanetario where you got all these podcasters and bloggers from all over the world saying,
"We'll give you the updates."
Yeah, pay attention during the weekend. We're going to give you all the updates because we were told that we would be getting the results and we'd be getting the pictures. We'd be getting the, and we got nothing.
Kip at MayaCast.com had zero updates.
So they made this whole big video introduction so that you could keep connected with the Interplanetario, and then none of us got any updates to share. So maybe
it was
get a Defiance. Who knows?
That video was funny though because we came in like the Kool-Aid man.
Yeah, it was.
Oh yeah!
All these people talking like, "Hey, you know, listen to our podcast. We'll talk about the Interplanetario. Keep connected." Or, you know, in Spanish, "This is my blog, and you can follow on my blog for all the updates for the Interplanetario and all this stuff." And it's and then all of a sudden, da 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 da. I was like, "Oh man,
maybe we went a little overboard."
A little bit.
Maybe we went a little overboard. I felt like the Kool-Aid man.
Beep boop. Anyway, so we should have that. So we should have a bunch of Defiance-y things to talk about very soon to get you psyched for this Kickstarter. It starts on Tuesday. It only goes for 3 weeks. So it's not like a full 30 or 60-day Kickstarter. It only goes for 3 weeks. So when it goes live, make sure you share it and tell all your friends because that's how you get the stretch goals, right? The more you get stretch goals, and who knows how they're going to run it, but a lot of Kickstarters, you get stretch goals not only for hitting financial goals, but also for social media goals where you hit so many retweets or Facebook posts or whatever. So make sure you, as soon as it goes live, you're sharing it with friends and really get people that maybe don't know Infinity, but are into board games, you know, involved. Because sure, a lot of people that play Infinity are going to go all in on the Kickstarter, but, you know, we... reach out to those people that don't play Infinity. Mm-hmm. That's the audience it needs to grow to hit blast through stretch goals and get everybody more miniatures or however it's going to work.
I have some people in mind, quite a few, that this is my gateway drug. Yes.
So that happened. That Rumble registration on Saturday. I want to say noon Eastern. That could be wrong. So double check the time, but make sure you're up early and get registered for Rumble before it sells out. That happens tomorrow. So hopefully you listen to this the day it comes out so you're prepared for tomorrow, ready to rock and roll with Rumble registration. Then Tuesday, Defiance Kickstarter. And at some point, a Defiance review from us. And it's a four-player game, so we might even be able to scrounge up like Chainsaw and Kazavan maybe to run through some games of Defiance with this prototype and maybe do a four banger episode.
It's like my first car.
But so thank you very much for listening to the 250th episode of MayaCast.
We are a quarter now.
A quarter of a millennia.
Yeah, we're a quarter of a millennia.
We're four away from a quarter of a century or something. But 250 episodes, that's bananas.
Dang, to reach 1,000, we'd have to be what? 20 years. It's like we're at 5.5 right now, right?
Yeah.
250. Wow.
So,
that
yikes.
Would be funny.
52 a year. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's if we don't miss a week.
Yeah, I know. My bad.
Like we just did.
Yeah. My bad. Sorry, guys.
Tell you what. Yeah, you were out of town on business, but we had just wrapped up Armageddon. I was kind of glad to have a week off. It's fine. Armageddon was an awesome time. Thank you for everyone who came. And if you're on the fence, get off the fence. Sign up. Do one of these big events with multiple states participating because they're super fun. They're your brothers that you only get to see 2-3 times a year, and it's a blasty blast. Thank you very much for listening. We'll be back next week. And until then, make sure you get out there and support your local game stores. And hopefully the Defiance Kickstarter will also have a way for you to support your local game stores. Fingers crossed.
To find out how you can support the show, go to patreon.com/MayaCast.
You can find us online at www.MayaCast.com.
We are on Facebook at facebook.com/InfinityMayaCast.
Follow at MayaPodcast on Twitter.
Join the MayaCast forum group on Facebook.
And as always, you can email us at tom@mayacast.com.
And kip@mayacast.com.